morning, as we share the scripture focus, I want to speak to that one who may feel like they've abandoned God, or worse yet, God has abandoned them. Romans chapter 8, verse 38. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will separate us from the love of God that is in our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord for you. Amen.
Well, those of you who are here, the Lord has given you gold star. Man, time change and rain. Oh, yeah. Glad y'all are here. You can tell there's some of us that aren't, and we're not going to judge them to their face, okay? Amen. Yeah. Now it's a church. This morning, I would like to ask us as a congregation to be praying for one of our members. Tina DeGraff, from what I understand, a few weeks ago, or maybe a month ago, had caught a unique diagnosis of leukemia and has been battling that and fighting that for a long time. And then from what I understand, this last week she got a secondary virus that is really, really working hard on her. And she's in the hospital. Many of you may have seen her a couple of weeks ago. She's the one that came in with the mask. But that's just one of ours. And so I'd ask that we pray this morning for her, but also that you would pray for her as the Lord brings her to your mind. Amen. Father, we come before you right now. We just lift up Tina to you and ask that your presence be with this family. Father, that your love would surround them. Lord, that you'd bring peace to all of them. Father, we know you as the great physician. We ask for your healing touch right now upon Tina. Lord, that you would move in a way of miracles and that she would be your walking miracle because you are faithful. Father, we know this does not escape your attention. Father, we stand with this family in agreement. Accomplish everything that you desire, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Quick question. We ask this quite a bit, and I believe it's important. What is the evidence of a Christian? It's one of those things that's been debated for a long time, especially in the West Texas culture. In fact, we have churches that disagree on this is a Christian and you're not a Christian. If you act like this, you're a Christian. If you act like that, you're not a Christian. And we begin to be very confusing. Know this, I don't believe being a Christian can come down to just your association with church. And yeah, I love the Refuge. Refuge is a part of my life as much as it is yours, but I'm sorry, if you think you're going to stand before God and go, Refuge, he's going to be like, yeah, what about it? But there is a defining attribute to somebody who's truly a Christian. It's not their ability to memorize scripture. It's not their ability to go through rituals. But it's simply what scripture tells us if they have love within them. That's what it is. And we talk about love all the time here. But it's so important to have love in action. In fact, there's so many scriptures that talk about the love of God and that we must be about love. But here's the thing. Love is difficult sometimes. Especially when you live in a world that does not exhort love, but prefers to hate. We live in that world today. This world, more than any time in history, and I know every generation says it, but I see more hatred than I've ever seen in my entire existence. Where we bring barriers down of culture, we raise up more barriers of hate, and I don't understand why, except maybe Christians aren't doing what they're supposed to do. in the 80s, my view of a Christian was somebody who carried their Bible everywhere they went. And you had to sing all the Christian songs. You didn't listen to any other music. Many of you are in this room right here. You know what I'm talking about if you grew up in the church in the 80s. You don't listen to Christian music openly, but you listen to different music privately. I mean, come on, Pyromania, Def Leppard. God, what an album, right? Maybe I'm exposing myself a little bit. Here's why love is so important. True love can change all atmospheres, but the most important atmosphere it can change is you. Think about this. If you're in a situation and people are arguing and they're screaming and yelling at each other, when an individual walks in and says, hey, let's relax, let's talk to one another, let's be calm, let's respect one another, it changes that entire atmosphere. We can do that today in our own lives. But the most important atmosphere that love needs to change is your atmosphere within. Because you're always going to be in a world of hate. But we need to be a people of love. In fact, if we read Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 16, Jesus speaks about two qualities or two examples of the quality of love. He says this: you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. I'll repeat that, gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Salt and light. Here's the unique thing about salt and light. Salt cannot be half salt, and light cannot be half light. I can prove it. We all lost an hour of sleep today. Satan himself stole that hour sleep from us. When your alarm went off this morning, the last thing you did was just turn on the brightest light you had. Right? Because it's powerful. And it hurts your eyes. You have to adjust. Well, same thing with salt. Has anybody ever had one of those little punk kids unscrew the salt cap before you sat down, right? And you go to, and it dumps out, and you hear him giggling, and you're like, no, it's no big deal. I'll just wipe it off. It doesn't matter. That salt is, it's salted. It's done. And I think some fast food restaurants do that anyway. It can't halfway be. The reason is, can't be specific, but it must be true to its own nature. Salt cannot say, I will salt this and pepper this. Light can't say, I will light this part, but I will keep this part in darkness. It either is or it is not. It's the same way with Christians and the love of God. You're either of love or you're not. Oh, but Pastor, I love these folks. Probably. But I can't stand these folks. But I love them because they love God too. But I can't stand them because they don't love God. Then don't say you're of love. You either are or you're not. Now, follow me here. It's not necessarily an emotional thing I'm talking about. If I pass around a piece of paper to every person in here and say, write down the definition of love, we're all going to get different definitions. Some of you in this room, you don't even want to hear the word love. It has been so misrepresented in your life, you don't believe in it, and you refuse to believe in it. I get it. But man's love is not God's love. God's love is unconditional. Our love is conditional.
as hard as we try to just love without condition, we're going to get upset and frustrated. In fact, isn't that the way the world is? Well, if they're not going to love, then I'm not going to love. And we wonder why God gets misrepresented all the time in our country. Verses 17 through 20, still in the same book of Matthew, the chapter 5. Jesus says, "Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you," this is important, "for I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven." Let's talk about the law. When you drive down the street, there's a sign on the side of the street that has a number on it, and it says speed limit. And a lot of us, if you're going to be honest with yourself, if that speed limit says 60, then we interpret that as 65. If it's 70, we believe God wants us to go 75. But it's a law. It's a law that if you break it, there's consequence. And then what happens when you see the 60, but you know it really meant 65, and then you get the light show behind you, and you get pulled over and you start blaming God? Why did you let this happen? And God's like, "Man, there was a sign." And the cop comes and gives you a ticket because you are a law breaker. But you go, "But I barely broke the law." 60. "Yeah, but I was going 63. Lawbreaker. Deserve a ticket. Isn't it funny? I don't know about you. I try to be as nice as I can to the cops. And it's a false niceness, I'm going to tell you right now. Right? I'm trying to be as nice as I can because I don't want a ticket. "How are you, officer? You doing safe? Doing a great job. That's awesome that you do that. Oh, you're really going to give me a ticket? Oh, I can't believe you." In fact, I had a pastor friend. It was really funny. He got pulled over and he was trying to pull his preacher card to the cop, right? The cop comes up and he says, "You were speeding." He said, "Yes, I'm a youth pastor at this church. I'm sure you've heard of it. And man, I'm just trying to get to the youth. Those kids really need me. I'm running a little bit behind. And you know, God forgives people when they do things that they shouldn't." And he said the whole time the cop's going, "Oh, amen. Absolutely. The Lord is good. And I understand his forgiveness and grace." And he's filling out that ticket. And the last thing he tells my pastor friend when he gives him the ticket, he says, "Hey, God doesn't want you to speed either." The law shows that we are all lawbreakers. And the reason why we could not fulfill the law is because love hadn't been made complete in us. Think about this. Some of you in this room might say, "Pastor, law says thou shalt not murder," and I've never murdered. Doesn't matter if you've broken one. You are a law breaker. So none of us are better than anybody else. Can I get an amen? With that understanding, the only way we could fulfill that law is if love was perfected within us and drove us to obedience. Give you an example. Why do we murder? Because we're angry and frustrated and mad. And some of you say, "Once again, Pastor, I've never physically murdered somebody." Some in this room. Let's just move on. I've never physically murdered somebody, but Jesus says if you've done it in your heart, well, you've done it. Man, that's tough. Why do we cheat? Why do we lie? Why do we steal? It's out of fear. We're afraid we don't have something that we deserve, so we take it and we steal it. Why do we lie? Because we're afraid of the consequences in telling the truth, so we tell the fake story. If perfect love was within us, then we would not fear. We wouldn't have to murder. In fact, we'd be the opposite. We want to restore life rather than take it away. The scripture that got me says, unless you surpass the righteousness of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. You have to imagine being a Pharisee, hearing Jesus say that to the people, as well as being a disciple, that he blew the people's minds, because the Pharisees and the teachers of the law back then were the law upholders. And you had to perform according to the law that they interpreted for you. So if you messed up, you had to do all these things to make it right, and according to them. And here Jesus is, the son of a carpenter, saying, unless your righteousness surpasses these guys, you will not even enter the kingdom of heaven. In other words, he's saying in regular terms, these guys are wrong. And that must have frustrated them. I can imagine them looking at Jesus saying, who do you think you are? You don't know us. We've been schooled in Scripture. We have gone through the strict regimen to become a Pharisee and a teacher of the law. We wear the Scriptures on our forehead. You do none of these things. You don't know who we are. And Jesus, I believe, says, on the contrary, you don't know who I am. You see, you perform the love of God. I live it everywhere I go because I am of the Father. Listen, we can perform our Christianity all the way to hell if you want. Can I get an amen? Just being real. We don't have time to play around. Because I could tell you, change your clothes, wear a cross on your neck, say Scripture all the time, memorize them, know the latest and the greatest Christian songs. But if you're not out there loving well, you have no evidence of Christianity. And it's not me saying that. It's in this Scripture. In fact, we can keep reading. After he talks about this, he begins to talk about murder, adultery, divorce, oaths, and eye for an eye. He begins to take all of these serious issues that they face and begins to tell them, you need to see it through the eyes of love. I encourage you to read it. On murder, he begins to say what we talked about. If you thought about it, you've done it. On adultery, well, I've never committed adultery. If you thought about it, you've done it. If it's in your heart, because that's what I look at. I look at your heart. That's why those who have physically committed these things, you're never going to be able to uncommit them. Can I get an amen? That's just a harsh truth. Once you've done it, you cannot go back and undo it. But if your heart is changed, then you are forgiven, and he will make you new. Man, how many times I've tried to force my way into being good. Has anybody tried to will your way to be good? I will not cuss anymore. I mean, even throw the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I will not cuss anymore. Only to find out you were a sailor the next day. Man, I tried my hardest. I can't do it. It's because you can't do it on the outside. It has to come from within. The love has to happen. Verses 43 through 48 says this. And once again, I do encourage you to read verses 21 through 42. I think it'll be good. Here's what Jesus says. You've heard what it was that it has been said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. There's the evidence. Love your enemies. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good. He sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Here's an important part. The scripture's telling you, love must become a part of who you are, not what you're obligated to do. Man, I love you in Jesus, but you better be glad Jesus is here. Or we tell somebody I love you and turn around and gossip about them to somebody else. You try to perform that out. And Jesus is telling us that love must be made complete within you. Now let's be honest. Have you ever loved somebody and just really didn't like them? It's hard. It's hard to love somebody that you don't like. But this scripture's saying, well, if you only love the people that love you, what good is that? Everybody does that. You know, if I only love people that are like me and think the way I think and listen to the music I listen to and drink spiritual Dr. Pepper. It takes effort to love those that don't love you. Our world is the way of, if you love me, I'll love you. If you hate me, I'll hate you. But when Jesus came, he said, I know you hate me, yet I will still love you. Even when they were nailing him to the cross, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. How can we expect to be any different and call ourselves Christians? Oh, but Pastor, I've seen where these types of people are ruining our country. No, they're not. You know what's ruining our country? You really want to know what's ruining our country? The fact that Christians aren't loving well. Well, they don't love us well. We're not going to love them well. They're not supposed to love us well. That makes us different. Well, I stand and fight for God. He doesn't need you to fight for him. He needs you to love for him. Oh, he wants me to lay down and die for others? Sure, maybe that's what his son did. It's hard, isn't it? Notice this. 1 John 4:11 through 18 is a beautiful scripture that helps us understand the importance of God's love and how we should be. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God, and so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Says it right there. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. I'll say it again. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out all fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Verse 19, we love because he first loved us. That part where it says love must be made complete in us. It's something that we cannot do ourselves. It must be done by God. And here's where the hard part comes in. It's not an emotional thing. It is an active thing. Love must be an action. You can't say, Lord, I will love once I feel like it. How many times has your emotions and my emotions betrayed us? Right? This is what God wants. to make his love complete in you and I. That scripture, be perfect, therefore as your heavenly Father is perfect. Has that scared anybody before? Lord, I can't be perfect. He says, I know, but my love can be made perfect in you. Oh, Lord, I'm ready for that. I'm ready for you to make your love complete in me, and I'm ready to feel it. And God goes, it's just not that simple. Well, Lord, what do you need to do to make your love complete in me? He says, I first must love you. Guys, if there's anything you hear today, hear this. Before one can love like God, one must be loved by God. You cannot love without being loved by God first. And here's the hard part about being loved by God. Many of you, including myself, do not think we are worthy of his love. In fact, we know we're not. But yet he comes and he says, I love you anyway. And we say, okay, Lord, you love me, got it. And the Lord says, no, I love you. Yeah, I got it. Jesus is love. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. I've heard it all. Here's the reason why we don't let God love us. Because if he's truly going to love us, he's going to carve out your resentments. He's going to carve out your fears. He's going to carve out your regrets. He's going to carve out your guilt. And that hurts. That makes us be vulnerable. And there's no other way around it. You see, the devil's trick, in my opinion, is he keeps trying to make us think we aren't loved by God. Do you believe he loves you, or will you even let him love you? Right? We let people love us to a certain extent, but don't get too close. That's when we get vulnerable. And God is, I'm all in. And we go, okay, Lord, you can come in and here, I'll give you this resentment and this pain, but I'm not going to give you what they did to me. And God says, you got to let me in. Nope, not going to. In fact, I've already buried that. I've already dealt with it, been to many therapy sessions, got the certificate of completion. And the Lord says, you've covered it. I'm going to dig it out by its roots. Therefore, you will overcome it. And it's hard. But once that's done, guess what? You have no fear. Oh, listen to this. And I'm not trying to step on toes, and I know I might be getting personal to some of you. Just know that's not my intent. But if God's doing it, better wake up. Some of you have some deep scars from other individuals that is not your fault. You need to hear that. I'm not blaming you. It's not your fault. However, God is saying you must forgive. And you say, oh, heck no. I am broken. And in fact, I'm still even mad at you. God says, give it to me. Give it to me. Forgive. And then he starts digging in. And once you're able to truly forgive, that's when you're free. Oh, that's when the enemy comes up and goes, do you remember what they did to you? And you go, yeah, and I forgive them. There's no more power over me on that. I am free from that bondage. And then the enemy's like, now what am I going to do? The God healed them. I mean, what am I going to do now? Nothing. So know this. Be loved by God. That's the scripture we read that Pastor Allen read. I want to read it again. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing. God loves you. He is all in. You and I need to open up and let him have free reign over the scars. And the pains and the regrets. And know that his intent is not to judge and harm, but to free us and forgive us. You know what happens when you get to that point, you can't help but love on others. If you and I finally realize how much God loves us, we can't help but love on anybody else. In fact, you become that Christian with the stupid grin. Driving down the street, somebody cuts you off and flips you off, and you're like, good to see you. Glory to God, how are you? Please go on ahead. Aren't you mad? No, I love them. How can you love? Because I remember who I used to be, and he loves me. Therefore, because he loves me, and I know that love, I'm going to love well. It's not what I do, it's who I am. That, ladies and gentlemen, makes us Christians. And for you, that's what makes us refugees. In the midst of darkness, we will be light. Can I get an amen? Let's stand together. Pastor Allen.
Let's read together. Woe to me, I am ruined, for I am a man with unclean lips. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hands. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Go and tell this people. Let's pray together. Father God, we do truly love you. Master, we thank you that your mind about us is made up, that your heart, God, is bent to us, that your desire for us is real, that your Son sacrificed in our place, resurrected, is true. Master, I pray for this, your people. That you would, God, bless them each and every one. That you would cause your presence to be realized. That in that, God, the enemy and the lies of the enemy would be defeated. Be glorified amongst us, God. Let us be part of that thing that you're doing in this place. Accomplish, God, all that you have in mind. Master, we surrender to that, to your will and your way. Master, for the varied amongst us who have lost loved ones and those even currently in the hospital, God, we ask for mercy. We ask for grace. We ask that you would be God. That you would be God. And God, we surrender to that. We accept that. God, we accept the infinite wisdom of the loving, creating God. Accomplish again all that you have in mind. We ask in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. God bless you.